Welcome to the Language Barrier Podcast, where we invite you into our conversations on a wide range of topics from two completely different cultural point of views. I'm Ryan Seigelke.
And I'm John Lutaya.
And on today's show, we're going to discuss our headlines, where my headline of the day is that Nadal is now engaged, and I think it's going to be the beginning of the end of his professional career.
And my headline is the trade news at Chelsea Football Club.
And then we'll get into our questions of the day, where my question of the day is, I want to ask John, what are the advantages he thinks he gained from growing up in the ghetto?
And my question one is going to be, what would you like to see improve in our societies today?
All right, with that, let's get on to the music, then on to the show. Johnny, what is popping around in that brain of yours today?
Oh man, what's popping in my head today? It's just some sad news. I think it's time for the world to give attention on some tragedies. We always pay attention to the big tragedies, but so there's this guy from Cardiff Football Club,
Emiliano Sala.
He was traveling in a plane going for, you know, it's January transfer. And what happened was, as he was traveling in a private aircraft, him and the pilot, and the plane disappeared. So we haven't found him in almost a week. And I think recently I had some news that the people responsible for doing the investigation and the searching were stopped. They were like, they lost hope immediately. They cannot find anything on the radars and everything. But good news today is that at least we are able to find some evidence behind. So they found a cushion they believe that would have been part of the plane. So the investigation is still going on. But I think, yes, it's time to think of these things. You know, traveling in a plane is serious, right?
Yeah, that's terrible news. And it goes right along with what's popping in my head today, too, of, you know, Grandpa Ted, you know, my father-in-law, his birthday would be tomorrow. And he passed away suddenly and unexpectedly a few months back. And I just say that we were grateful to have known him. We miss him.
Yeah.
And want to wish him the best, you know, up in the heavens. So on that note, now that we're starting off with death as our main topic of what's popping, let's get on to the headlines and we'll have a little fun talking about Rafael Nadal. So Rafa, it was announced that he engaged with his longtime girlfriend, Mary Perella, when they were vacationing in Rome.
Yep.
They're reported to get married in Mallorca this fall, where they're both from. And they've been dating for 14 years, which sounds very Ugandan, minus the five kids and a goat, I have to say. And in my prediction, I think this is the beginning of the end of his career. And I'll tell you why in a minute. But he's not ending now. He's still going to try. But yeah. I think based on our conversations in the past and how we think their team takes tennis very seriously, which they should, right? It's his living. It's work for all of them. He didn't get married for 14 years for a reason. Why now?
You're asking me?
Yeah. You follow these guys closely. Tell me why you think now.
I don't know. That is, I think that's a personal thing. I can't really tell what's going on in Nadal's life. But what I can say is, I think it's time. You know, marriage maybe in Spain, or marriage for Nadal maybe is taking it the Ugandan style, where we don't rush into marriage.
He doesn't have five kids, though. So it can't, it's different than Ugandan style.
But the process to get married, it's, it looks like a Ugandan style. He's taking his time. And yeah, after 14 years of dating, now he's decided to marry. I think that's a good step to go forward.
Oh, 14 years though, holy moly. We talked about this in a previous podcast, but 14 years is a really long time to be not even engaged, to just be dating.
It's not a long time. Oh, it's about time. What matters is, I think all these things is just how the society has been shaped. You're still living with the same person when you're married and when you're not married. So what difference does it make?
Well, it's a statement. It's saying, you know, I think it's saying that I'm making a commitment to you, a true commitment. And here's a sign of that. That's what it's saying.
Okay.
Leslie and I were together for, I think, 2 years before I engaged or proposed to her. And I think I've heard, you hear many stories of women in the U.S. who are were engaged for, or not engaged, they were dating for a number of years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. And not only the woman, but also the woman's family is waiting and saying, hey, when are they going to ask you the question? When are they going to pop the question? You guys going to get married sometime soon? So in the U.S., there's a pressure for that. I can definitely see the cultural difference of you're very relaxed with that. And I'm like 14 years dating. That's a long time. And it's impressive. I respect that.
Yeah.
But it's certainly not the culture that happens in the U.S.
Definitely. Yeah. I see friends, like some of my friends getting married after college. And yeah, marriage is rushed. But in Uganda, you know, you take your time. You're even allowed to have babies before marriage. That's how, like, we have that big trust. I mean, marriage is kind of, I would say it's like a retirement thing in Uganda. Because when you get married, it's like after you've accomplished all the big achievements of life, you know, with your partner, getting kids, having a house, kids are graduated in school. And I also think, like, from our cultural perspective, I also think it's beautiful. How beautiful for you to see your kids when you're getting married, your kids witnessing your marriage. Have you ever thought of that?
No, I've never thought of that. I mean, I think there's something beautiful about what you're saying too. It definitely gives me a different perspective on you know, 14 years, you know, or a decade long of that you're just dating.
Yeah.
And then getting married and then having your kids see it. That's an interesting perspective. I could see that. I think it's different though. It's definitely not the way I was raised. I have definitely a biological reaction when you're talking about, you know, just dating somebody for 14 years. You know, it seems like it's missing that next level of, hey, let's actually officially say we are together. But I think times are changing in the U.S. It's not there.
Yeah.
But I, you know, there's a good friend of mine who is monogamous with one woman.
Yeah.
He lives in Chicago. He's monogamous with one woman. He has one kid and one kid on the way. They are not married. And I think maybe for this reason that they don't want to be labeled. They don't feel like they have to put a stamp on something or be rushed into something that maybe they're not ready for just because that's the way it's always been done.
Yeah.
So I think it's an interesting way to do things. And, you know, you see things change in the U.S. I wonder if it's changing in Uganda at all, where maybe people are starting to make that commitment maybe slightly sooner, or what ways marriage is progressing in Uganda too.
Yeah, it's also changing. It's progressing. Some people do it sooner as maybe 5 years of being engaged together. I think it also depends with, you know, the culture now, because we have so much connection in the world. Cultures are able to view each other so easily. We can, somebody in Africa, somebody in Asia can see what's happening in America through the TV shows and the lifestyle, right? So we have that access of accessing culture so easy. So I think, like in Uganda, some people are quickly adapting, you know? They would like their marriages to be sooner. I know a friend of mine, you know him, right? When we went to Uganda, I remember Alan, one of the buddies when we were just Karim, the brother to Henry?
Yes, of course, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's funny. He was very funny. Yeah. Loved him. He was awesome.
Yeah, so Alan got married, actually, was it last year?
Okay.
So it depends. Some people decide to take it early. Some people decide to stick to the cultural thing. But for me, I think, right, you have to wait if you can. Do some things that have to be get done, like for Nadal, because it's the topic. He had to concentrate on his tennis. And yeah, Nadal is successful. The wife is not going to run away.
Well, you never know. But here's the point about her not running away. And I think what death brings to light for me, you start to experience death loss. Both of my grandparents, who I was very close to, you know, we were supposed to have two more kids. I got to see them be born and die in my arms. You know, they were born prematurely. You know, we see Ted pass away. You talk about the footballer who passed away. We hear it on the news all the time, people passing away. And it makes you realize that life is short and you don't know when your time's going to be.
Mm.
And so maybe in some ways, you know, that's a reason to get married. You know, I see the argument of not being labeled. You don't have to push that forward. But maybe there's an argument of saying, listen, I don't know how much time I have, but I want to commit to you and I want to celebrate and I want to get our friends together and celebrate it together to show you how much I love you. That could be a reason to do it as well.
I mean, yeah, I respect your view. Nothing to say about that.
But maybe that's what Nadal is noticing too. He's not getting any younger, and you reach a certain age where you start to see the light at the end of the tunnel, even though he's, you know, in his late 30s, right?
Yeah.
And he's starting to see that tunnel, although it's still a long ways away. He's starting to go, okay, now what does life look like after tennis? What do I want to be a father? I want to be a husband. You know, all those things start coming up, you know, about what your legacy is beyond tennis too. Yeah. I wonder if those things are hitting him, but that's all speculation. We don't know. But Before we move on, let me give you a few examples of people whose careers went to hell in a handbasket once they got connected with somebody.
Okay.
So Chris Humphries was famously known for, he married Kim Kardashian for 72 days.
72 days?
Yes. Yeah, 72 days. So that's, what's that, a little over, what's that, 2.5 months?
That's right.
Something like that. So he got married for 2.5 months. He was averaging a double-double during the season before he became married to Kim Kardashian.
Mm-hmm.
And then his numbers were immediately cut in half the next season. And I think even the, in half again the next season after that. So his careers went down the toilet. Justin Verlander won the AL MVP as a baseball player and the Cy Young Award. And then later that year, he became an item with a supermodel. And then his career quickly went down the toilet. He ended up choking away one of the ALCS games against the Detroit Tigers. And his career was never the same. Alex Rodriguez, who's also a baseball player, he played for the Yankees. He went from winning titles, slugging home runs, to batting 111 in a crucial 2012 ALCS showdown against the Detroit Tigers as well. And maybe Justin Verlander wasn't against Detroit Tigers. I think I got that mixed up. But anyways, those are three really prominent figures. Chris Humphries, not so prominent. He became more prominent because of the marriage to Kardashian. But he was a good basketball player. He was on the rise. And, you know, making that commitment to somebody else, you know, maybe it focused away from their career and they went downhill a little bit. But those are speculative and kind of funny. I don't think that's going to happen at all. But those are some examples of maybe a little red flag here we should watch out for.
Well, maybe Nadal is just transitioning, right?
That's what I'm saying. Transitioning, yes.
Yeah, things may not go bad, but it may just transition, just like how we saw Roger Federer when he discovered he was getting old and he has two sets of twins to take care of. He cut down on the tournaments, number of tournaments playing. So maybe that's what Nadal is trying to do. Once he's engaged and wants to focus on family, what's next? He will maybe choose what to do now and yeah, will be just the legendary figure.
He'll definitely be legendary. I'm just saying that I think the end may be closer than we both expect.
Well, I don't doubt that. He's old. Time to move on for Nadal.
All right,
I'm happy for him.
Let's get
Aren't you happy for him?
Of course. Of course I'm happy for him.
Okay.
He's been dating for 14 years. That poor woman should. She deserves to get married to him now.
But they must have so much trust in them. So
I believe it.
That's a strong relationship.
Okay, let's move on to your headline now. A little bit about Chelsea?
Yeah, my headline, Chelsea. Let's talk about the news, the transfer, the trading news in Chelsea. It's a tight situation for Chelsea Football Club. One of the big transfers they have this season is they brought in González Higuain.
Who hasn't played yet, right? We saw him on the bench for the first time.
He played. He played on Sunday, the FA Cup.
He did play. How did he do?
He didn't score, but yeah, he was there. He made his first debut with Sheffield in the FA Cup. So yeah, Higuain currently, if you don't know, he's a Juventus striker, but he's living a very tough life. He was loaned to AC Milan because that big summer transfer of Cristiano Ronaldo coming in, they needed to take away somebody for Cristiano Ronaldo because, you know, Cristiano Ronaldo is a big guy.
Yeah.
He cannot play half games or he needs to play full games. So they had to eliminate someone and unfortunately, it had to be Higuain, poor Higuain. But Higuain was performing well in Juventus just because of Ronaldo, the big guy. So Higuain was loaned to AC Milan. He was in AC Milan on loan. He didn't do that great. AC Milan is loaning him to Chelsea. Poor guy. Before I continue, what do you think of Higuain's life now? Do you think he's emotionally stable to perform very well after all those occasions?
Why not? He's still on one of the top 4 or 5 football clubs in England.
Yeah.
A very famous team. Has lots of rich history.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's probably still getting paid a lot of money. I don't know if you know what the transfer amount was, how much he's getting paid. I'm sure he's still making good money.
That up. Yeah.
And they needed him for the position, right? So he'll come in and be able to make a direct impact on the team, right?
Mm.
So I haven't seen Higuain play that much, but what I do know about him, he does have kind of a weak hairline, right? He looks maybe in his late 40s, early 50s, and he's probably in his mid-20s.
Yeah.
But no, I know he was a very good player for Juve, right?
Yeah.
For Juve, and I think he'll make it's what Chelsea needed. You were talking about who they needed before. Is this somebody you think can fill that role well with Hazard?
We don't know. What we know so far is that Higuain has a very good relationship with the Chelsea coach right now, Solari. They are once in the same team, so Solari brings in Higuain because, you know, Higuain was struggling and he sees that. And since they have a strong connection and Chelsea doesn't have any good striker right now, Hazard has been representing the fall of Giroud and Morata. So those are great losses for Chelsea.
I have to say, though, too, did you know that he's actually getting his Premier League debut right now as we speak?
Yes.
Did you know that 13 minutes ago starts 0-0 versus Bournemouth currently?
Okay. Hopefully he scores.
Live update right there. You see that? See the type of value we're bringing to people that are listening.
That's right. That's all we're about. It's all about soccer and good information. So for Chelsea, the situation is so tough. They've sold Morata. Morata is going to go to Atletico Madrid. So Higuain is coming in to save Hazard from that central player where he was trying to look for goals and stuff. So much is going on Chelsea. We don't know what's happening. The latest news actually from Chelsea is the coach Solari has given Hazard the option to leave the club if he wants. You know, Madrid has been in talks with Hazard, and Hazard sometimes has come out strong to say he wants to stay in Chelsea and do all those great things. But at the same time, maybe sometimes he doesn't feel happy. We don't know what's happening. But yeah, Hazard could be out of Chelsea in the summer. So Chelsea, they're not looking great.
Well, they're really shaking it up. I mean, they're really trying to rebuild the team, it sounds like, and making tremendously big moves, right?
Yeah.
And it seems different than it used to be maybe 15 years ago, 20 years ago. I didn't follow Premier League then, but I know how sports is just so high pressure now.
Yeah.
There's more social media than ever. We have more connection to the players and coaches and organizations than ever, which makes if a team's not winning, they feel the pressure to change immediately. There's not really that loyalty to a player for a long period of time.
Yeah.
Like he used to, kind of like Arsene Wenger, who was relieved of his job from Arsenal last year. He was there forever and they probably needed a change, but they had some loyalty to him, felt the pressure they needed to make a change. You know, there were fans in the stands holding signs that, you know, get rid of Wenger and all that good stuff. But I don't know. You feel like times have changed in the Premier League, that there's not as much loyalty as there used to be?
I would say yes, because I don't think it's even about the loyalty. Loyalty has always been there in soccer, and it has always been a problem. So it's one of those good things we talk about. Too good, too bad. If you're doing well, the fans will love you, the club will love you, you will have all the loyalty. If you start to fall, we don't have the loyalty for you, unless when you're old. When you're about to retire, then we can have loyalty for you. Great legends, we can talk about Giggs. You've heard of Giggs in...
No.
Giggs in Manchester United? Very good player. So when he was retiring, fans were still loyal for him, even when he was struggling. Another one, you may know of this one. Your Liverpool fan, Steven Gerrard.
No, I don't know. Steven Gerrard, no.
Oh, my God.
Remember, you're the football expert. I'm really just new to soccer in the last, like, 2 years. I've really gotten onto it last year because of you and RJ and Jesse. You know, kids are into it. Dad gets into it, too.
Yeah, I've been telling you to learn your history. Liverpool history, it's going to be big for you.
Yeah, I know Jurgen Klopp. That's who I know. Mohamed Salah. That's who I know.
If you want to proudly put on Liverpool jerseys and sweatshirts. Yeah,
I'm wearing one today.
Hang around with Liv. You need to know your history.
You know my history that I know? I know that we are in the lead right now. 60 to 54?
Yeah.
Currently? 60 to 56.
Yeah.
And hopefully more than that by today. Liverpool's playing right now too. I'll have to keep a live update on that. But that's my history that I do know that I want to share
with
you.
That's the current. Well, history will be if you win the Premier League, which I think...
That's future. We're not there
gonna
yet.
Get you.
Let's see.
But yeah, Chelsea are really struggling. And if you don't know Chelsea in the past, they've been really aggressive. Chelsea has one of the richest bosses. You know the boss?
No, who's the boss of Chelsea?
Roman Abramovich. One of the richest people in the world. Very aggressive guy. One of the big, big transfers he triggered was when he got Torres from Liverpool.
Okay.
Yeah, he paid a lot of money for Torres to come in the Liverpool, and he has always done big transfers. Him, if he likes a player, he will always bring the player in. But recently, I don't know if he's not falling in love with the players we see around or anything else. He's not so much involved in triggering the big checks to bring in players.
Live score update, though. Sorry to interrupt. 1-0 Liverpool over Leicester City right now. Sané scores in the third minute of the game. They're in the fourth minute of the game.
My God.
Just a live update for you. Not rubbing it in, just letting you know.
Maybe it was the bad time to shoot the podcast.
Perfect time to shoot the podcast, of course. No, but it does look, I mean, Chelsea's mixing it up. They have a new coach. They're giving the option to their star player to go somewhere else.
Yeah.
They're kind of saying, we want you to go, is what it sounds like to me. Mm-hmm. They're bringing in Higuain. But it looks like they're mixing it up. I'm curious to see what they'll do, not this season, but more like next season. Because it doesn't sound like they're gearing up for this season to kind of really make it happen now. Yeah, but they're kind of getting ready for next year.
They do need this season, as we know, Premier League. All those big clubs, that's why you see coaches being sacked every time. Those big clubs, Chelsea, Arsenal, Manchester City, Manchester United, Tottenham. It's all about the four places, right? Number one to number four. So if things are going wrong, they need to be a quick reaction. And for Chelsea, that's one of their main worries, to make the top four so they can go back in the Champions League. If they don't, somebody's going to be in problem. Could be the coach, could be a couple of players.
So, probably both, huh?
Yeah. So that's why they're trying to do their best here to make ends meet.
Now we need to get the coach of Chelsea some Nicorette, the nicotine gum. He looks like he's jonesing for a smoke over there on the sideline. I know he's notoriously known for going out on smoke breaks. So, okay. So anything else on Chelsea? You want to move on to our questions of the day?
Let's go to the question of the day.
Okay. So my question of the day today is, what are the advantages you gained from growing up in the ghetto? I'm really curious. I think there's probably some unique advantages to problem solving that you gained through, you know, you had a great mom, but she had to work. She was a single mom.
Yeah.
And that left you alone and have to figure some things out in the world well before maybe you were ready. But ready doesn't mean that you can wait. You have to do it. Life moves on. So I'm curious, what are the advantages you gained from growing up in the ghetto in Uganda, in Kampala?
Wow. This is a good question. This is one of the things we as kids from the ghetto never get to think about or get to ask about. But if I can pull it up really quick, I think one of the things I learned and the advantage right now is taking responsibility. You know, that was a major thing. Mom was away going to work and I was home very young. I had all the responsibilities at home.
What age was that?
That was as early as maybe 6 or 5.
Mm.
Yeah, so the early years, maybe I was with my sister. My sister was home, but she was also going in school and going to work at the same time. So for me, I would go to school, come back home, do home chores, wash my uniform, just make sure everything is okay, and then play. And then the funny one that I will never forget, one of the big responsibilities I had was we had this local stove. The stove is where you light it with charcoal.
Mm.
And for you to light the stove, you need to light a lot of paper. So you burn paper so it burns the charcoal, and then the charcoal starts to, you know, be hot and so you can cook.
And you're learning this at 5, 6, and 7, yeah?
Yeah, so that was around, 7, 10.
Wow.
So that was my responsibility after I come from school, do all the chores. Mom is about to come home, that is around 8. My responsibility was to light the charcoal, to light the stove. So when she comes, I have to make sure the water is boiled, because she liked to bathe hot water. So boil hot water for her to bathe. Some water, maybe we use it to cook porridge. So that's like the meal before the main meal. So cook porridge, then she would then go in and cook, and then we eat at around 10.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, my responsibilities, I think that was a big thing. Just knowing to take care of things and learning. Started learning to do the home chores, then going to light the charcoal. Then as soon as I knew I was able to cook, my mom taught me how to cook. So sometimes I would cook. She would be like, John, cook this food tonight. And she would come when I've cooked food and, you know, we go. So I think responsibility was big. Growing up in a ghetto, you have to be responsible because mom is not going to be there. And another thing I learned is you can't be greedy. You cannot be greedy when you're in the ghettos. There's nothing to really hold on to. Everything just looks average. You cannot be greedy. You cannot desire anything because you don't have that. You cannot. So just that mood of just being there, living life, you know, I think was beautiful when you grow up and you see all those things, good things coming to your attention. You don't go out of your way to get excited. You always keep your calm. So for me, from that experience, I've learned to keep my calm. One other thing I can say was the lifestyle. The lifestyle is so different that you're always going to be just hustling, never giving up. Hard times come in, but you know, you're not going to give in. You have to, you have to keep going. There's no time to get emotional. You know, I've told you about that before. And you're like, John, it's okay to get emotional. And I'm like, no, in my culture, it's not okay to get emotional. There's no time for that. You cannot cry when mom is not there. You cannot cry when you have no food. You cannot cry when things go bad. You just have to move on. And I think that was the key, you know. Bad things happened in my life. And I think one moment that I got really emotional was when I lost my scholarship. So I was in Kenya, rumors came in, and I had a bad time there. So I was put on probation and suspension. My scholarship was at risk. I think when I came back to the ghetto, that was the only time I think I got so emotional and I cried, because I was like, now what's going to happen? I'm already a big boy. I've been so committed into tennis and this life of just looking for a better step after Nairobi, maybe going somewhere in the States, or just finding connections to keep moving the path. And all of a sudden you see the path is gone. I think that made me really cry. Cried for maybe 10 minutes and it was over. I had to move on. Small cry. I had to move on and quickly react back to the journey, not giving up and keep seeking for stuff to go on. So
seems like there's a big lack of fear too. I ask you all the time, are you scared of that? And you're always telling me no and no and no. And I keep kind of challenging you on that. But there's a friend of mine that was a professional boxer. We've talked about him before. He lives in Colorado and he's amazing. You know, he was a very good football player. He tried out for the professional. He tried out for the Indianapolis Colts. Yeah. And while he didn't make it, but while he was training to kind of try out again, he started boxing in his early 20s, really late to try a sport.
Yeah.
And he found out he was really good at it, went on to be a heavyweight champion. And I think to be that good at something, especially that late in life, most people would be so fearful that they're fighting people that have spent a whole lifetime already, you know, 2 decades or a decade and a half in a sport and have so much more experience. But he grew up in a really terrible environment. You know, he grew up, he was literally born in jail. His mother was addicted to drugs. His dad was a petty thief. And then he was in foster care until, I think, maybe 10, 11.
Yeah.
And he had wet the bed that whole time. You know, he just had seen so many terrible things. He was so damaged from it. And I think when you've seen the worst that life can give you and you've survived it, maybe fear, which is most people's biggest crutch, is diminished.
Yeah.
Not gone, but maybe much less. And there's much less fear to try new things and accomplish, which I think could be a tremendous advantage for you as you, you know, finish up one more year at Linfield.
Yeah.
And go out into the world, right? Where you're going to have to, you already know that life is not easy. It's not going to be given to you. There's going to be challenges everywhere. So.
Yeah, definitely. Something to add on fear, I think that goes away, because when you're growing up, you like what you talked about, you grow up all seeing all these terrible things happening. And to some extent, this fear is terrible. Me as a person coming from the ghetto, I know this fear has led to, the lack of fear has led to some youth being killed, losing their life. You know, you see all these terrible things happening, you get stronger, and all of a sudden you lose the fear, because like some of the things that happen would be like, kids would get involved into stealing. And because people are so poor there, if you caught stealing, that is one of the terrible situations to be in. Somebody's going to put all the frustration on you. You're taking away all their time of hard work. So usually what they do to the thieves when we get them, I don't know if it still happens, was the community and the people, when they get the thief, they'll burn the thief to ashes. Or beat them to death. So if you really see that, sometimes it's good. You're like, okay, I'm not going to steal. You learn from that. If I steal, I'm going to get killed. And at the same time, I've seen kids who are not afraid. Maybe they stole the first time, because usually when you're caught stealing the first time, it's like the punishment goes up. Maybe the first time they forgive you. If you're a child, maybe they give you some canes and whip you so bad. Next time, if you keep stealing, they just keep beating you to death, maybe break your bones. So if a child goes through all those few temptations and he survives, steals, get caught, beat up so bad. Remember, when they're beating the child, he's getting stronger. And the fear to steal, he's losing it. So he's always going to be fearless. the child keeps stealing and stealing, gets older, steals, and that's where the community gets fed up and they just kill the child. That's a strong one. So fear to some extent is good, to some extent is led to bad things.
There's a really bad side of that too, of a kid who survives all of that is now damaged in many other ways too, right? Which is tough to overcome as well. But yeah, that's amazing stories that you're telling. All right, so let's wrap that up and let's move on to your question of the day.
All right, my question for the day, Ryan, is what would you like to see improve in our societies today?
You have this smile on your face where you know what my question back is going to be to you. John, please, why don't you start us off? What would you like? That's such a broad question. There are so many things.
That's what right. Like that's why we're here to talk about things. So, just me and you, from your angle, from my angle, you know, our podcast, some things we just don't want to rely on.
I do a lot of talking. Why don't you lead us off this one?
No, it's my question for you. I just want to hear from you.
What just would like I like how to you be? Asked me. Sure, I'll give you one. You want to hear one?
Yes.
So one thing I'd like to see changed about our society is that hatred is now celebrated. You see it on Twitter and on social media. People are quick to throw stones at each other.
Yeah.
And throw hatred, and it's really easy to do when you're not facing them eye to eye. So you're seeing lots of hatred being thrown around. It's celebrated. You see it with our commander-in-chief in the White House, who loves to use text and talk badly about people.
That's right.
He did it during his campaign, and he got elected by talking badly about people. The little Marco and things like that of other running mates. He was making fun of Marco and his height. So if you ask me, one thing I'd like to see change is that we all treat each other a little bit better.
Okay. Yeah, that's a strong
point. So it's a strong lead right there. So tell me, follow it up. Let's go.
Okay. Like for me, if we talk about these things, like I think the society nowadays, as I told you, growing up, responsibility was a big thing. And I think the society is losing responsibility. Responsibility for oneself, responsibility for another self. You know, people are responsible for looking out for kids, looking out for staff, making laws or just making society a better place. We're not taking this thing of drugs seriously. Drugs are affecting the community, the societies right now. I would like to see some improvement on drugs, make the drugs expensive or eliminate drugs, just like how they're trying to eliminate cigarettes, right? Me and you, we always talk about every time we walk by Colfax or anything, mental health, and one of the big problems is just abuse of drugs. Coming from college, I experienced this every day. Kids abusing drugs all the time. And who knows? Who knows where we're going to go? You know, the campus safety, one of their biggest responsibility is looking out for students not getting poisoned from alcohol. So all these things happening, we want to control them, but how are we going to control them?
Well, you know, you think about the college issue, that's like a rite of passage for many young American and international kids. They're used to being under the wing of their parent, and now they're free. I am free. Maybe you've been free for a long time, but some kids have not. So now they're experimenting with many different things, and in some ways that's not so bad, except for the ones that happen to maybe get hooked.
Yeah.
And maybe fall into, maybe they get expelled from school, or maybe their grades get so bad they get kicked out of school. You know, those are the ones to be afraid of. Well, what do you think is the solution then? So I know there's many countries who have legalized drugs, so they've kind of taken away that the scarceness of it, right? So if something's scarce, we want it more. There's some mysticism about it. I'm not supposed to do this. But they legalize it, and that seems to have made things better in many countries that do that.
Yeah.
Is that the answer?
One of the answers, just making it a simple thing, you know, not restricting kids, maybe especially from alcohol, you know. Like in Uganda, we can drink when you're 18. So, and when you find kids drinking, they rarely have that alcohol poisoning and stuff. And I also think it also has to come to one of the biggest ways to move forward is education. I don't think there's enough education on drugs.
Well, that's a good idea. I mean, education is always a positive, right?
Yeah.
Getting to know something more accurately.
That's
taking
right.
away that mysticism is a good, it can always be a positive, right?
Yeah.
Learning more is always a positive. I'm just reading an article here on thefix.com about Portugal who decriminalized all drugs. And then what they happened next was they had a high risk of HIV through needles and injecting. And Greenwald in the article says, by freeing its citizens from the fear of prosecution and imprisonment for drug usage, Portugal has dramatically improved its ability to encourage drug addicts to avail themselves to treatment. So it seems like things get better once you kind of take away those extra mystical things around drugs of like, I'm not supposed to do this or I could get in trouble for doing this. You know, things can get better.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. So just talking about it and bringing it to the attention, you know, it's I think it's time we start talking about drugs in our societies, just as we're talking about race. So maybe that will improve, you know, kids have that choice. And if we educate the kids, they will know the good choice. And giving the kids the freedom to express, you know, it's not like when a kid comes out or there's some kids use the drug and they're really scared. They don't want their parents to know anything. That's what gets it terrible.
Well, I mean,
the kids is using drug and doesn't want the parent to know. If now they're addicted, what they keep going on is getting their own separate house.
Yeah.
They want to move out. So the parent is no longer keeping responsible. I don't know.
Well, I think what's really interesting is you bring this up and you are somebody who does not use drugs. You really don't drink at all. You will occasionally have one beer after soccer. Right.
Yeah.
But besides that, you don't really partake in any of this. You've really had a lot of courage when you're at college, and I presume you're at parties and there's lots of pressure to take drugs or to have alcohol.
That's
right. You seem to stand up in the face of it. So what about marijuana? Marijuana is now legal. It's been legal in Colorado for a number of years, and now it's becoming legal across the states. How do you think that's going to affect, you know, kids in society moving forward? In Denver, for example, moving forward, do you think kids are going to use this as a gateway to get addicted to more drugs, or do you think it's going to take away the mysticism of it and be kind of like, oh, it's like smoking cigarettes, I could do that, but it's bad for me, I'm not going to do that?
Yeah, talking about marijuana, I think marijuana is, since it was legalized in many cities, I don't think it was a good idea, because marijuana itself, before, it was just a very good thing, I would say good herb, you know, was very simple, had less effects on people. But now with the legalizing of marijuana, it's a business. And you know what happens in a business? So much goes on to it. There is mass production and there is that influence to make the drug even more addictive, more nice to the kids, right? So the marijuana I know right now is not the marijuana I used to see people smoke many, many years ago. A kid will smoke marijuana right now and they get high just like that. It's like they add some more chemicals into marijuana, right?
I can tell you from my own usage, I smoked a lot of pot in high school, a little bit after high school and in my 20s. And then I really have not smoked in nearly 10 years.
Yeah.
And what I would say is that it is much stronger now.
That's,
you know, we were at a party recently and somebody at the party who had been drinking and maybe wasn't used to smoking pot, decided to go out with another group and smoke pot. And as they did, they came back in and they were white as a ghost. And one of the guys there actually owned, I don't know if he owned a dispensary, but he was in the marijuana industry. And he was kind of like, yeah, we see this all the time. Weed now is so strong. People aren't used to it. They think they can have a couple of drinks, a couple of glasses of wine and then smoke. And then this is kind of what happens. They get sick. So the weed now is definitely different. But, you know, Colorado's reports that come out, they're saying that it's not really affecting, like, usage amongst young people has not gone up. It has not impacted the graduation or dropout rates. You know, they're not seeing these things that everybody thought, like, you know, it's a slippery slope. We introduce marijuana, then they're going to get addicted to all these drugs and society is going to be terrible.
Yeah.
In some ways, many view marijuana as similar to or even a better option than drinking alcohol. You know, you smoke weed, worst thing you're going to do is drive really slow down the road and maybe stop at 7-Eleven a couple of times on the way home and get munchies. As opposed to if you drink too much and drive, you could kill somebody. And I think that it's probably some truth that if you smoke marijuana, it affects your ability to drive too, and that could be bad. But it seems like the effects are not as severe as alcohol.
That's right.
And what do you think about that? I mean, what do you think about going into a liquor store, you know, and seeing marijuana, you know, seeing a joint right next to a package of joints right next to, you know, your Bud Light.
Packet of joint next to my Bud Light.
Or next to the alcohol. So you have your alcohol section, you have your weed section in your local liquor store. I think that's the way we're moving.
Yeah. I mean, it's all, again, it needs to change. That's what we need to talk about, right?
Yeah.
These things are just getting too out to be excess. And there's no education. Kids are just using them overly. Over, way, way over. And it's causing kids to not focus in school, not focus in all their dreams. It's killing dreams, even in adults, you know. It's like I told you, marijuana of nowadays, as you've also seen,
yeah,
it's not the marijuana we used to know. So
yeah, it's funny too, because when I stopped smoking marijuana, I had a terrible experience with a pot smoker. And such a bad experience that it was like, nope, I can see how this person steals and the way that they act towards other people.
Yeah.
I don't want to be like that. And that was my moment where even to today, where I'll have the urge to go, you know, pots around. It's very readily available.
That.
I'd be like, well, maybe I'll try some today. And I'm like, nope, don't want to be like that. Guy was lazy. He stole.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to be like that. And I don't think everybody's like that.
Mm.
But since then, I still, you know, I think there's two things happening. One, there's a ton more people smoking pot than I actually realize, number one.
Yeah.
But number two, the ones that I do know that smoke pot, I wonder how many of them are really doing that well. Because it seems to make you more stagnant than it does to seem to make you get up and want to go and, you know, kind of conquer the world or, you yeah. know, be ambitious.
It's an addiction thing. It just wants to, it's like any other drug. It's like the collection of drugs is just to make you change your lifestyle. I mean, drug addict is a lifestyle. That's all you're going to do. Well, that's all you're going to do to know best in your life, right?
Well, addiction is a disease too, though.
Yeah.
Much like a mental illness. So, you know, some people don't really choose to have this addictive gene in them.
Mm.
And then they try something and they kind of get hooked on that. Or reality is not that good. Their life is tough. Maybe they've got some damage, like some of the people we talked about in Uganda who
yeah.
gotten some beatings and they're damaged from that.
Mm.
And reality is pretty tough, so they want to escape reality. You know, I'll say for myself that when I think about smoking weed, you know, I do drink. I'll have a couple, one or two beers a night or something like that, or one or yeah. two drinks a night. And like to come home and wind down. But for me, I'm not that interested in having 5 beers, 10 beers, getting drunk or smoking where I'm escaping reality.
That's right.
Life is a challenge. But I think leaning into that challenge is what makes life interesting.
Yeah.
And facing those challenges, they're not insurmountable. And I don't want to escape. I've got a great wife. I've got great kids. We live in a fun area. And I love living life. So I think that's what keeps me away from getting drunk or at least getting drunk often.
Yeah.
Or also, you know, smoking marijuana or trying to escape reality.
Yeah, I would agree. Definitely. We need to change this in our society, take responsibility of drugs.
Okay. You want to make it legal then?
Hmm?
You want to make it legal? Is that your...
I don't have the power. But if I had the power, not make it illegal, but yeah, just...
Make it legal. Like legalize everything. Make it... Hey, it's not...
Make it rare. Anymore. Make it rare, just like how cigarettes are disappearing today, you know?
Well, cigarettes are disappearing, right? They know it's terrible for you.
Yeah.
They're not allowed to market in certain areas, and they increase the price so much that it really does take a hit on your lifestyle if you're going to decide to smoke. You know, my dad smoked for years. My grandmother, who passed away, has smoked for years too. You know, my grandmother died of cancer, and dad... I think from seeing his parents pass away,
yeah,
we kind of decided, you know, it's time to make a change. And it was expensive. It's expensive.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Okay.
It's a big, broad question. Maybe you'll be a little more specific next time.
we'll keep bringing it up.
But we should
expanding on these things. There's so much to talk about in our society. Yeah. So
sure, sure. Okay. Well, that's a wrap for us. Make sure to rate us 5 stars wherever you get your pods. Follow us on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter at L Barrier Podcast, where we're going to be posting the boxer that John mentioned yesterday, as well as the music John mentioned yesterday. So please check that out.
And also, don't forget, sharing is caring. Talk with us on languagebarrierpodcast@gmail.com.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Until next time.
See you soon.
Bye-bye.
Who knows what I know? Every day's a hustle, but I one thing me tell you, never give up in a life. I remember how much work you've been putting in day after day. Waking up early in the morning, working out late in the evening. Remember, because of the number days, a man will not always be stealing. No lying, Jah will serve, no fear.